round, pink, tender shell, opening and closing, closing and opening. A vagina is a flower, an eccentric tulip, the center acute and deep, the scent delicate, the petals gentle but slow. I did not always know this. I learned this in the vagina workshop. I learned this from the woman who ran the vagina workshop, a woman who believes in vaginas, who really sees vaginas, a woman who helps other women see the vaginas by seeing other women's vaginas. In the first session, the woman who ran the workshop asked us to draw a picture of her own unique, beautiful, fabulous vagina. That's what she called it. She wanted to know what her own unique, beautiful, fabulous vagina looked like to us. One woman who was pregnant drew a huge red mouth with screaming and coins spilling out. Another very skinny woman drew a big serving plate with a kind of Devonshire pattern around it. I drew a huge black dot with little squiggly lines all around it. The black dot being equal to a black hole in space, and the little squiggly lines being people or things that got lost there. Particles and objects from the surrounding environment. I had never thought of it in practical or biological terms. I did not, for example, see it as something as part of me, something attached to me. In the workshop, we were asked to look at our vaginas using hand mirrors, and then we were to verbally report to the group what we saw. I must tell you, up until this point, everything I knew about my vagina is based on either hearsay or invention. I had never even seen the thing. It hadn't even occurred to me to look at it. I must tell you, it had never ever occurred to me. It seemed so reductive and awkward looking at it like we were in the workshop with our hand mirrors on our shiny blue mats. It reminded me of how the early astronomers must have felt with their primitive telescopes. I found it unsettling at first, my vagina. Like the first time you see a fish cut open and you discover this other bloody complex world right under the surface. It was so raw, so red, so fresh. And the thing that surprised me most were all the layers. Layers inside layers, opening into more layers. My vagina amazed me. I couldn't speak when it came my turn. I was speechless. I just couldn't. I had awoken to what the woman who ran the workshop called vaginal wonder. I just wanted to lay there, my legs spread, examining my vagina forever. It was better than the Grand Canyon, ancient and glorious. It had the innocence and freshness of a proper English garden. It was funny, very funny. It made me laugh. It could hide and seek, open and the workshop asked how many women had had orgasms. Two women very tentatively raised their hands. I didn't raise my hand, but I had orgasms. I didn't raise my hand because they were accidental orgasms. They happened to me. They would happen in my dreams and I would wake in splendor. They would happen a lot in water, mostly in the bath, once in Cape Cod. They happened on horses, on bicycles, on the treadmill at the gym. I didn't raise my hand because although I had orgasms, I did not know how to make one happen. I thought it was a mystical, magical thing. I didn't want to interfere. It felt wrong getting involved. Contrived, manipulative, not hollow. The surprise would be gone and the mystery. The problem was, of course, the mystery had been gone for 2 years. I hadn't had a magical accidental orgasm in a long time, and I was frantic. That's why I was in the vagina workshop. So the moment had arrived that I had both dreaded and longed for. The woman who ran the workshop asked us to take out our hand mirrors again and see if we could locate our clitoris. There we were, with a group of us women on our backs, on our mats, searching for our locus, our center, our reason, and I don't know why, but I started crying. Maybe it was the sheer embarrassment of the thing. Maybe it was knowing that I had to give up the fantasy, the enormous, life-consuming fantasy that someone or something was going to come and do this for me, that someone was coming to lead my life, to choose direction, to give me orgasms. The simultaneous terror and realization that I had avoided finding out about this, had rationalized it as mainstream and consumerist, because I was, in fact, terrified that I did not have a clitoris. Terrified that I was one of those constitutionally incapable, one of those frigid, dead, shut down, dry, apricot-tasting, bitter, oh my god. I lay there with my mirror, looking for my spot, reaching with my fingers, and all I could think about was this time when I was 10 and I lost my gold ring with the emeralds in it in a lake. How I kept diving over and over, running my hand over stones and fish and bottle caps and slimy stuff, but never my ring. The panic I felt, I knew I'd be punished. The woman who ran the workshop saw my insane scrambling and sweating and heavy breathing, and she came over and I said, "It's gone! It's gone! I've lost my clitoris! I shouldn't have worn it swimming!" She laughed. She calmly stroked my forehead, and she told me that my clitoris was not something I could lose. It was me. It was both the essence of me. It was the doorbell to my house and the house itself. I didn't have to find my clitoris. I had to be it. Be it. Be my clitoris. Be my clitoris. So, I put the mirror down. I watched myself floating above myself. I closed my eyes. I watched as I slowly began to approach myself and re-enter. It felt like very, very quiet, like an astronaut re-entering the surface of the Earth. It was quiet, this re-entry, quiet and gentle. I bounced and landed and bounced, and came into my own muscles and blood and cells, and it came and slid into my vagina. It was suddenly easy, and I fit. Oh, I was all warm and pulsing and ready and young and alive, and then, with my eyes still closed, I put my finger on what had suddenly become me. There was a little quivering at first, which urged me to stay. And then the quivering broke open into an eruption, the layers dividing and subdividing, and the quaking broke open into an ancient horizon of light and silence, which opened onto a plane of colors and music and innocence and longing, and I felt connection, calling connection, as I lay there thrashing about on my little blue mat. My vagina is a shell, a tulip, and a destiny. I'm arriving as I'm beginning to leave. My vagina, me. Here is a vagina having left. The clitoris is pure in purpose. It is the only organ designed purely for pleasure. The clitoris is simply a bundle of nerve fibers, 8,000 nerve fibers to be precise. That is a higher concentration of nerve fibers than is found anywhere in the male or female body, including the fingertips, lips, and tongue. And it is twice the number in the penis. Who needs a handgun when you got a semi-automatic?
Finally, a surprise. Triple.